I say?
3rd.
23rd. Thank you. 24th. I have to mention one thing before I begin. I had bad news today. It's personal. A friend of mine died. I would like first to have a moment of silence for Victoria McGrath, who also has passed away. I think we know that's the reason our flags are at half staff. She was a victim of the Boston Marathon bombing and then also of a terrible car accident recently in Dubai. So let me see if I can be heard. So I'd like a moment of silence for our victim of terrorism. Thank you. The meeting tonight will begin with a Pledge of Allegiance, and I asked Fran Goldstein to lead us in that.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our first item on the agenda to discuss is to accept the resignation of Ryan Cornell from the Board of Assessment Appeals, effective March 16th, 2016. And is Ryan here or coming? Andy, was Ryan going to come? No. Do I have any discussion? Any motion?
So moved.
So moved. A second.
Second.
Any further discussion?
We wish him the best.
I would just like to extend our thanks to Ryan Cornell, who has been a terrific member of the community. He has always brought forward as a volunteer water for different civic functions and events, festivals, and has been a very valuable member of our community. Thank you, and I wish him well. Next item on the agenda, discussion decision regarding giving permission to Angels of the for the second annual Angel Aid fundraiser to sign up lemonade stands in Weston. Okay, and this is Jennifer. Would you like to join us at the table? Okay. Thank you for being here tonight.
So it's kind of last minute, so I have some of the information here. I'm sorry. My husband wasn't home to print.
Okay. So the fundraising is to benefit children and families with cancer.
And rare blood diseases.
And rare blood diseases.
Financial hardship.
Our financial. How did they come to you?
Through a group of girls in Westport. Have been working with Al, who owns Soccer Tech Suites. Mm-hmm. I don't know his last name. And it's his charity, and he's been doing it for 20 years. Okay. And last year was the first year that he got a bunch of people together to organize the event. And there were over 50 stands throughout Fairfield, Weston, Westport, and Wilton. And they raised $65,000.
Wow.
And all of the lemonade and cookies are completely donated by Paul Newman's own and ShopRite. So it's a great way for the family to come out. And they're really just asking as people walk by for donations, have a glass of lemonade, have a cookie, would you like to donate to Al's Angels? Mm-hmm. I did it last year, and it was wonderful. My 2-year-old son had a blast. So we hope a lot of people bring their kids.
Who mans the stand?
So each stand gets a person who mans it. So I'll be manning a stand. A couple other girls in Weston will be manning stands, and then everyone in Westport gets a stand. And then someone can sign up for an hour, 2 hours, all day, however they want. But there's one person that manages each stand.
And when will this take place?
June 4th. Mm-hmm. Rain date, June 5th, but we're hoping, you know, even if it's cloudy, cool, it will be June 4th.
And how many stands would you like to put up in West?
3.
And where would they be located?
The Skagway, Morehouse, and the Library. I think okay. The same as last year, because I was in Westport last year. And I know that Holly, who I'm subbing in for, has gotten approval from Parks and Rec and the Library.
Okay. The Skagway?
Morehouse. And the Library.
And the Library. And have you talked to the ladies at the library?
I know she has.
And okay, she so oh, this is already pre-approved. Mm-hmm. Okay,
I guess pending your approval.
Okay. All right, may I have a motion?
Well, I just had a question, a couple of questions. One was, how do we do compared to other towns? Do we need to get our citizens to step up?
Well, we only have 3 stands.
Per stand?
You know, I think there's just more traffic in Westport and Fairfield, and they do a more commercial areas. But I heard the library and the Skaggy were great last year. I don't have the actual ones. I could get them for you, and I can send them.
That's fine. And that actually leads to the second question is, how are you communicating this, and is there any way we can help sort of with marketing communication to spread the word?
It'd be great. Three of us that live in Weston, we've kind of kind of taken over the Weston group, which last year they didn't have that.
Right.
And we're all, you know, we know lots of people between the preschools and the Hurlbit. It seems like mostly it's Hurlbit and the preschools. And we're asking families to come on out and sign up and just get the word out. It's really word of mouth. Right. I think Al does his own marketing, but I'm not really sure where. I could, you know, definitely find that out. I think he puts up a big sign on Main Street in Westport.
Would it be reasonable to put it on our website, on the town website?
I will think about that.
There is issues with, you know, then if we do it for one, we have to...
If you do it for all, yeah.
But there are other mechanisms to spread the word.
I would ask, however, that our newspaper reporter Greg Menti is here.
Okay.
I think that is one good place. And the other place you might go to is Catherine Rifson of Moms in Weston.
Yes, yeah. I'm on and, that.
Okay.
And we'll be all over Moms in Weston.
But I think that would be the first likely way to reach the public. Because that goes out to
Memorial Day Parade, if we could put that flyer and do something, you know, in town, yeah. That would be a good idea.
And you're not going to put any independent lemonade stands out of business with the support of the Selectmen, right?
No.
Just want to make sure.
Yeah, no. So it's nice because everything is donated, which is great. So it's, people don't have to buy the lemonade, it's just a donation to us. And it was $65,000.
How much is the lemonade?
No, it's free.
No, how much to buy the lemonade? 50 cents, a dollar, do we know?
Oh, it's by donation.
It's by donation.
No, but when somebody buys the lemonade.
Whatever they want.
Whatever they want to
give. It's
whatever
a donation.
Whatever
okay.
A little kid could give me a quarter, a penny. Whatever they want to give, they could give $5, $10, a dollar.
And then
we have cookies that are donated from ShopRite. So it's really nice. And there's a pizza and poster making party the week before, so the kids get involved that way.
Sounds lovely.
Sounds good. Mm-hmm.
Hours,
I think it's from 10 to 5. I can confirm that. It's all day. So we have to fill the stands. But I think if they break down a little earlier, if it's slower. But I can confirm and have Holly email you, Randy, the actual signs.
Yep.
Okay. I will definitely get that to you tomorrow.
May I have a motion?
I move to give permission to Al's Angels to set up lemonade stands in Weston at the following locations: Morehouse Park, Segley Park, and I guess the in front of the library.
May I have a second?
Just to modify that, on June 4th with a rain day, June 5th.
Okay. Yes.
Okay.
Sounds good. And may I have a vote? All in favor, please indicate so.
Aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank
very
you so much.
Much.
I look forward
Thank
to
you
it.
Very
Thank
much.
You very much. Appreciate it.
Discussion decision regarding internal controls and policies. This is a brief update on in terms of our check writing policies and our internal controls. We are looking to review those issues. We are also looking, according to the finance department, to check whether we want to engage a different auditor. We have used the same auditor for many years. Am I audible? Thank you. We've used the same auditor for many years. It's normal practice to consider other possibilities. So I asked our chief financial officer, Rick Darling, to give me an idea of how we handle our check writing and our internal controls policy. That has been distributed to the selectmen. Mm-hmm. Is there anything you'd like to comment on that?
Well, just, you know, as of this point, all of our audits have come out clean and we've done
Absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely.
Did you have any particular concerns about the way it was going in terms of any modifications you wanted to make?
First of all, I have complete confidence that it's been done properly up to this date. I, however, coming in with a fresh set of eyes, realize I have not been asked to write a single check. Mm-hmm. It is facsimile. Different towns do it in different ways. I'd like advice on whether that should be continued or revised. The other thing is a lot of towns have a threshold. In other words, at a check at a certain level, you have a live signature. Mm-hmm. So these are issues that I'm just questioning. Sure. I also have contact with other First Selectmen, and I'm aware that problems do arise. We have none. I'm very grateful for that. But I think it's just taking a fresh look at it. And if we are going to, as the Board of Finance is pursuing right now, look at changing auditors, I think this is a part of that to be looked at.
Any idea of the timing on reevaluating the auditors?
That's the Board of Finance decision.
Okay. That's all.
Am I correct, Tom?
It is the Board of Finance.
It's the Board of Finance.
By state statute, they have to appoint the auditor by June 1.
By June 1. Our fiscal year ends July 1st, so it will be in place for the next fiscal year. So we are very fortunate that we have a well-run town, and I thank Tom for that. And I would thank all the other people involved. But I think we just need to review this and see if there's other things we should be considering. All right, so there's no motion with regard to that. That's really just a discussion. Dennis, do you have anything you'd like to add?
No, other than I think it's a good idea from time to time. It's good hygiene to review your internal controls. And I think this is a subject that we should get advice from a financial professional, whether it's the auditors or someone else. But I think they would be able to tell us what controls are standard or preferred in similar municipalities. So I'd welcome that.
I am aware that in Easton, for instance, there's no facsimile checks by the First Selectmen. That to me seems to be a little bit, I mean, to have a lot of checks for $10 sounds unnecessary.
It's going to hurt your wrist.
It would hurt my wrist, exactly. So, but I am sure I can tell you that in contact with other First Selectmen, different towns do it differently. I'd like to benchmark what we're doing. I'd like to just make sure we should continue either doing the same thing or revising it in some way.
Every vendor check has a live signature. Every vendor check.
And who is signing?
Me.
Okay.
So it has two facsimiles. I get all the checks every 2 weeks. I go through them. I sign, initial the invoice. I initial the check. Not payroll checks. That's done a different way, but every vendor check.
Is there a threshold?
No, it's every check.
It's every check. Okay. So we'll have this conversation, Jeff, when this happens.
And we're not reevaluating Munis or anything like that. That's what we have. So the other vendors are staying stable. It's just we're looking at different others. Okay.
It's just part of the auditing.
Keeping up with best practices, sure.
And just checking that we're doing it the right way. Property tax refunds. We have a few here to authorize. May I have a motion? Is this agenda item number 5?
I move to approve the property tax refunds as listed on the March 24 report, select an agenda for a total amount of $1,071.72.
May I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? May I have a vote? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Thank you very much. And number 7. We are now going to vote on the approval of the Board of Selectmen's minutes. We'll do it individually. February 8th, 2016. May I have a vote?
I move. I move to approve the minutes from February 8th, 2016.
Second. All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. February 9th.
So moved.
Seconded.
All those in favor?
Aye.
So moved. And February 22nd, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay, thank you very much. This is not a long meeting. We have only two First Selectmen updates that I'd like to mention to the public. An update is an informational piece of an informational opportunity. It is not a discussion, a decision, or anything more. So I'd like to remind the public that the elderly, the senior tax relief application deadline is May 16th. In your recent newsletter, for those of you who may apply, there is a newsletter from the Senior Center. There's a column that will explain what the tax relief is what tax relief is available and who may apply. So I would refer you to that. I'd also refer you to the town website, which has the same information. The second update, because we had this discussion for the last Board of Selectmen's meeting, is an update regarding the selection of an architectural firm for the assessment of 848 Northfield Road. The Gadara family has requested that we no longer refer to that property as the Gadara property, because it is not. It is 48 Northfield, but that's the same property we're talking about when we call it 48 Northfield. The committee that was here last meeting, which was our building committee, requested that we put out an RFP, which is a request for proposals to more than one architectural firm. More than one was enlisted and interviewed this past week, and I am awaiting a recommendation. We are awaiting a recommendation from that committee, which will be forthcoming next Wednesday. That's the informational update. Yes, Gail.
Thanks, Nina. I would ask that you consider expanding the architectural review to include the potential to put land use in the 48 North House as 48 Northfield as well. I think that there could be many options as to what we do for that house, and I don't think that the public should just be given one option of moving 4 full-time employees and 2 part-time employees when there's a potential to actually house our land use there, demolish the annex, and save an additional $55,000 a year.
I'm under the understanding that it's not large enough for land use.
It may be, but the initial space survey has already been done. You should have a copy of that. If not, I'm sure Randy does in the files. I did hand everything over to her. From when we did the initial survey with the schools, when you were on the Board of Education, you might have that for those files as well. So I would ask that you see if perhaps you can put land use in the lower level and relocate finance and potentially the town administrator's office to the upper level.
We will take that under advisement, and thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think it's a good idea to keep all options open and keep as flexible as possible.
We have not written anything in stone and submit. Yes, Sarah.
I'd like to ask the same question I asked the last time I was at a selectmen's meeting, which is, certainly in the articles I've read in the paper, there's been no discussion whatsoever of the departments in the annex, as Gail just mentioned. What is your plan for them? I know that you've proposed moving for a selectman, the town administrator, for finance to 48 Northfield. What is currently your plan for the town hall annex?
I'm very glad you asked that question. First of all, the annex has at least another 5 or 6 years. Second of all, there are more than, I can name, I think, as many as 5 options of what we have as possibilities for land use, if land use is your issue.
Land use, I believe social services is there. I believe there's some PD there. I'm not sure, I think you could give me a more extensive list of what's in that building, but 5 years is not a long time. And if we're talking about a renovation and expansion, I know that there's many options on the table. I don't understand how we are not including all of the town departments and how we can only look at some of them knowing that in 5 years, we're going to have to find a place for that, those other.
But that's not what we're dealing with right now. We're dealing with an emergent situation with a police department that has a liability issue that we can address now. We can also, excuse me, may I finish?
I didn't say anything, I just
Okay, excuse me. I can't recognize you until I finish.
I know that.
Okay, you can put your hand down, I know you're next. There are more than one ways in which we can address the annex when the time comes. For instance, by that time, the enrollment in the schools may be much less. Some of those offices may be going from the central office into one of the school buildings, which opens up central office as a possible location for some of those offices. there are other issues that I'd like to...
But you yourself have proposed using central office as a senior center. Is that still your...
It's an option. It's an option. But none of those things can be determined now.
I disagree completely. I think that if we're looking at spending, whether it's $5 million, $8 million, millions of dollars, the taxpayers of Weston, we need to understand what the long-term plan is. Pick a plan and move forward. Otherwise, in 5 years, we could be looking at spending. I mean, if the Board of Ed moves into, the superintendent's office moves into the middle school, there's been discussions about costs associated with that. As a taxpayer myself, I would like to know, what is the plan, what is the cost before I make any decision
I would welcome talking to you about that at another time. I'd also like to say that I saw on Facebook a statement that you made that was utterly untrue.
I don't know what you're talking about.
You posted on Facebook that I had stated that because of my relationship with the first, with the superintendent.
I never posted anything like that on Facebook.
I printed it out.
I'm sorry?
I printed it out.
It wasn't.
It was not you?
Okay.
I would welcome Sarah the chance to talk to you offline.
Okay. I just wanted to state in a public forum on the record that as a town, we need to have a comprehensive plan for all of our space so that we understand the cost for everything moving forward. Before we spend money on buying a property, renovating a property, a historical building for which there's unknown ballooning costs down the road, you own a historical house, you understand that for sure. And I believe as a taxpayer, we need to understand the whole picture before we make any decisions on the short term.
Thank you very much. Do the selectmen have anything to add to this? I appreciate we'll take
yeah,
it under advisement.
I think that's a reasonable thing to have a comprehensive plan, even if it's going to be phased in. We don't deal with the annex till the annex has to come online. We should have a plan of what we're going to do with it and factor in those costs into the overall plan so we can do an apples to apples comparisons of the various options. Right now we're pursuing one option and we'll see where that leads, but we do need a comprehensive plan because we do have 5 years to build it.
I kind of agree with the whole idea of looking capital plan 5, 10, 15 years down. I agree with that, but that's fine. We will address that issue. Yes, Susan.
Thank you. I understand, Madam President, that you're calling the need for a new police department an emergent issue. It's actually an issue that's been around for a number of years that we need to solve. But I agree with Sarah and I agree with some of the other speakers and other conversations that I've had in Weston that we can't really do this piecemeal. To say that the police department is an emergent situation, so we need to deal with that now, and the plan for dealing with the police department would be to renovate the town hall and then renovate 48 Northfield, does completely ignore everything else that needs to be moved or addressed in the town of Weston, and as I've heard it referred to, it's a $5 million band-aid that isn't going to last 5 years. And one of the things we prided ourselves in Weston on is looking at something that will provide for Weston going into the future. And quite frankly, once you rip this town hall apart to make it into a police station, you can't get that back. So if in a few years it should be decided that maybe more offices should have been here, maybe more offices should be down in 48 Northfield, or the annex isn't going to survive, we can't go back and redo it. So there have been the plans on the table, the new police station, which was actually not $14 million, as I've heard quoted, but $7.9 million to put in a whole new facility. It's going to be, when we finish with it, it's going to be only slightly more than the anticipated cost for renovating this building and buying 48 Northfield. So I think there is so much on the table that we can't just turn around and say, well, the police department's emergent and we have to do it right now. And I am a police commissioner and I know how incredibly foul those conditions are downstairs and how not up to code. But I don't think that we should be rushing to do a renovation or to purchase 48 Northfield so you could move out with a couple of other staffers and make more room for the police station. That is not what should happen. This should not be a knee-jerk reaction to the fact that we need to renovate the police station. What we need to do is see what's best for the town and look at all the renovations that need to be done. Look at the fact that if the annex is going to be gone in 5 years, its useful life is over, Why aren't we considering what to do now? Do we want to be back in this situation in 5 years, putting another Band-Aid on everything? And that's what I think needs to be done. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Susan. Yes, Margaret.
Susan, you're absolutely right, because there are any number of ways. I think if we do nothing, if what I call the Robert F. Wagner School of Public Administration work out my PhD planning, if you do nothing, and then you put it aside, half of the problems go away. You keep putting it away, and then we can do nothing. Unfortunately, in Connecticut, we're 169 towns at the moment, and the state of Connecticut has its own ideas about what it wants to do. And I'm afraid, I'm really afraid, that Weston, if you take 5 years, the legislature may decide to do something else, and we may never get this chance again to be ourselves. Thank you.
I would like to address the issue of 5 years. I mentioned 5 years. I'm told the annex has 10 years. So this is not a situation that I would go out and bond to build a brand new center as the other alternative 10 years before we would need it and pay for it 10 years ahead. Yes, sir. Your name, please.
My name is Andrew.
Your last name and where you live. Palladino?
Yes. Okay. Hi, thank you.
And where do you live?
I'm sorry?
What street?
I live in Weston. Okay. 26.
Okay.
So I'm curious, like the architect, you talked about the architectural firm, like how many firms have been, you know, have provided RFPs, and how many options are they looking at, and what's your time, approximate time frame on deciding this?
The number of firms that were put out to be, the RFP and the number of firms that were interviewed happened before I was elected. So that is not, I'm going to ask.
I believe, if I may, are you referring to how many firms we first selected referred to for the 48 Northfield Road project?
No, I assume he's assuming for the police department. Are you talking about, nobody has been hired yet for,
right,
the police, for 48
right.
Northfield.
Right.
For the police department, Tom Landon will have to tell you what the RFP was and how many firms came to us. I have no knowledge of that.
But how many options are there between 48 Northfield and the police station? It seems like
Well, let's answer the first question.
Here, so I'm just trying to understand.
Let's answer your first question, Tom. How many architectural firms bid?
Well, I don't think we did a bid. I'm trying to remember.
The police commission, if I may answer, I believe that they interviewed three firms, and then we jointly decided to go with Jacunski Humes because of their background and specialty in public safety complexes. But I think Andrew's question, and Andrew, I'm sorry if I misquoted, but you wanted to know how many firms are being interviewed to look at 48 Northfield now.
Right, because that's part of the reconfiguring here.
That was an RFP that was put out by the building committee, and they accepted two responses that have been interviewed, and we are waiting, as I said in my update, for a recommendation on those two.
Alan, can you give us a status on your the state of interviewing and what you forecast to be the decision-making process?
The gentleman asked a different question, which is a really interesting question and important question. And that question that he asked was how many options are being considered in this review, correct?
Right.
So I'd like to answer that question. And then I'll give you the number of firms we've looked at and what the RFP addresses. We've been directed at this point to look at a single option. Not to look at competing options, or to look at the merits of one option against another. That single option is moving several offices to 48 Northfield. I prefer to call it the Dudero building, but I'll stick with the plan here, 48 Northfield. And then adaptively reusing part of this building for new police facilities. That's the single option. We put out an RFP, I think today, Tom, or was it yesterday?
Yesterday.
We put out an RFP yesterday that breaks down all of the services we're looking for in exploring that proposed move. There's 8 or 9 services. That RFP is going to 2 firms, which we previously interviewed at our last meeting at the building committee. They are in turn responding to that RFP with their own proposals, which would include a fee structure. We'll see that response next week. The building committee then will review those responses. We've already looked at and interviewed the firms, and we'll make a proposal and a recommendation to the selectmen shortly thereafter.
Thank you, Alan. The building committee is an advisory committee to the Board of Selectmen. And yes, we have asked that you advise us because you wanted to include more than one firm. You wanted an RFP for this, to consider this option, and we are pursuing that. And we welcome your advice in a next Wednesday.
I apologize if my question was, you know, misconstrued or there was confusion. I guess it's because, if, you know, as a town member, I don't really know what's taking place, so I'm just curious as to how these things are happening. So.
Well,
thank
you. You mean want to have Gail?
So you want when what was an extensive planning process that included looking at many options when she was first select woman for the relocation of the police station. And at this point, all of those options are off the table.
None of those options moved forward over the last 3 or 4 years. So we have discussed winnowing them down to what appears to be the most viable option. I'm going to ask Dennis to mention, to respond to some of this, because you have been on the Board of Selectmen for this long time.
Yeah, I think in general this is a very good discussion. I think it's really important to have as broad an input as possible into these important facilities decisions. I also accept and agree with the concept that we should not spend millions of dollars without a plan for how to complete the project. And I think that should be part of any proposal to the public to spend money both buying the property and renovating it. The only thing I would say about that is that because this process is going to evolve over the course of the next 10 years, let's say, and there are some contingencies as to what's going to happen during those 10 years, including whether certain buildings will be available or not available, I don't think it's necessarily possible to put a plan in stone today, but I don't think we should move forward without a clear vision as to what we're going to do under various scenarios that are realistically likely to take place. So that's what I'd be looking for in this. And I think the process of going through architects to make sure that A, we know the cost of renovation, and B, that we know that the once we spend that money, that the space will be appropriate for what we're going to use it for, are both very important. So that's why we're going through the process.
You know, in terms of cost, you know, it came to my attention recently that previously, going through the records, there were multiple plans on the table. And Alan, would you just briefly describe, I think there are two main plans that came out of that initial study. One of them is the one that we're referring to, the 9.8 million, but there was another one that was
7.9 million. It's been referred to as a $14 million.
Right, okay, so we got
the actual document, which I have in my possession here, which was cost estimated by a professional cost estimator, is $7.9 million, which was to construct a new police station to what is the west of the fire.
But just for clarification, $7.9 million was for the police station.
That's what I'm saying.
Let me finish. It did not, it's important because it's apples to apples. It did not include renovation of this building for the purposes that are intended. So
that's 1.4.
Yes, I know exactly what it was.
Let me finish.
My only point is that when we use numbers, we should use apples to apples numbers. And 7.9 does not equate to a complete solution. It was a police station.
You're right. But what it does equate to, which I would have been the second half of my sentence if I hadn't been able to fit, is it equates to what has become a $3.3 million project now to build a new police station here.
Agreed.
Which also doesn't include site planning and the acquisition of the Northfield property or the renovation of Northfield property or any of the other things down the road, moving the portables down. So the apples to apples equation I was going to make was police station versus police station.
Agreed.
And that police station project was more expensive. It did different things and it had different opportunities to it. And it fit within a long range plan, okay? That's all I was going to say, other than the fact that there's been other numbers bandied about, which were just not true. Like a $14 million number I've heard over and over again. I've not been able to find that in a single document.
It was never $14 million.
Thank you.
Excuse me, Alan. I had heard from someone 12 to 14 by the time you included the renovation of the police department when it moved out. So that was what I heard. I have seen, however, in looking back at the documents and the estimates prepared by KG&D, that the actual estimate was something like 11.9 million. So I'm off by that much.
That's not the actual estimate was 7.9 plus 1.
That's the police department alone.
Plus
that's not apples
1.
To apples.
8.
I have, it's in the...
Again, yeah. The reason I brought the question up was there were multiple proposals in there, and I assume that was somewhat costly a study, right? To get the KG&D study done. And there's a second part of that it involved sort of building on to here that was much less expensive, right?
There was KG&D, this point of information.
It's a price for the option.
They did an option where a building, or as I call it, a module, would be built just north of this building, onto this building, grafted onto this building. And that would be in the parking area where the police department is, right, where the police park right now, between here and the tower. And that option was planned not for a police department, but rather for bringing other facilities into the town hall under one roof, okay? And that was also costed out, okay? Now that plan is a viable option to not use to bring other facilities in, but rather to increase the footprint of the police department adjacent to where it is right now. So that's a plan that could be studied. I think that's what you're referring to.
Yeah, and that was significantly less expensive.
Significantly less. And that project, if that project would be considered, it would be similar in price to the one that's being considered with the Northfield property.
That's all. But, and there's been some groundwork on it.
Excuse me. We had a conversation with Humes about that to get an idea of what that would cost. And basically what I heard him say, and I had a couple of people in a conference call on that, is that the cost of bumping it out that way, if that's what you're talking about, per square foot would be
that
twice
way.
As much. Yeah, as moving into existing space.
Humes has always said to me, and we've spoken architect to architect on many, many occasions, that the cost of renovation and the cost of new construction are about the same, about $500 a square foot all in. So, if you're building 10,000 square feet for a police department, whether it's renovation or new building, we're talking about $5 million.
Well, Humes has said to me repeatedly now that the cost that we're offering to the town for renovation in this plan is $220 per square foot.
But that's been bumped up because now the cost was we've gone from 2.4 to 3.3 now. So
we're not talking about the Gadara property or all that. We're talking about the renovation within this property for the police department alone.
There's no way to build out anything for $220.
This is, at this point, we have what they've been asked to do, Humes and Jakunski, whom you hired, at the request of the selectman. He has gone as far as he's gone with the money that he's been paid to go that far. Getting further into the actual bids and so forth, what they would cost, requires the Board of Finance to give us more money for them to do their architectural plans. Yes, Sarah.
Okay, so So far tonight, I've heard of three potential options. I'm an analyst, I like to look at the data. What I would like to see as a taxpayer are, here are the goals of this project. There was a goal of improving the police station. I know at some points there was a goal of having a main entrance where a person in an emergency can go and get help 24 hours a day. There was also a goal of getting rid of emergency vehicle traffic from in front of the library and town hall where people are walking. I don't know what the other goals were, but I would like to see what are the goals, what are we trying to accomplish with this project, and then what are the options, what are the costs for each one of those options, and a cost benefit of does this solution meet the goals as we have stated them as a town, which is why we started this whole process in the first place.
Okay,
in order to make an educated decision about what are the costs and is this what's best for the town. Something that has not been discussed, you're talking about costs of renovating, not renovating, building new per square foot. No one has discussed the operating cost of a new building versus an antique house. And I know when I bought a house, I bought a new one because I didn't want to pay to the operating cost of an antique because the heating's bad, not the heating, but the insulation, all of those issues. So again, that's something else that needs to be considered. What are the future costs of putting town offices in a historical building versus a brand new building, or one that already exists?
Thank you, Sarah.
And I don't believe that we have all the information to go forward and make an educated decision as a town.
Thank you, Sarah. Susan.
Thank you. There were and have been options on the table before, and you are in the error, Nina, when you say that the plans for the police department were put aside for 3 or 4 years. They were not. They were put aside, unfortunately, when the election started and as a result of the election.
I believe Jakunski and Humes was hired 3 years ago.
Pardon?
I believe Jakunski and Humes was hired 3 years ago.
I didn't say, but you said that the plans were inactive for 3 to 4 years, is what you said before. That's not what you were referring to?
I was referring to the fact that my understanding is that Jakunski and Humes was hired 3 years ago.
And they may have been. I don't know exactly when they were, but we had a set of plans from them that was from last summer. And things, as you can see, have turned out differently. What I'm wondering is, right now, any other options seem to be off the table, and the police commission has been asked to approve only one set of plans, and that's the plan to renovate this town hall and turn it into the police department. And that would be in conjunction with renovating the Norfield property. And it seems to me that the entire plan to do the police department is contingent on what happens over here with the Norfield property, and nothing else is being considered at that time, because I know that there you have a time limitation on the option with the bank, and I don't know whether or not there's been any discussion of extending it. But what I am getting afraid of is that because there is a desire to buy the Norfield property, that the police department is going to get really almost short shrift. Yeah, we can live with almost anything that's better than what we have now, but it is not going to serve our needs long term. It may serve our needs for 5 years or more, but that's ridiculous. And is it being done, and the architects have only been given, or the building committee, one set of options to consider because the town wants to acquire the former Patera property now known as 48 Norfield. So I would agree with Sarah. There have been various options, and I think the public needs to see all the options, all the plans, and all the honest costs laid out for them so they can understand. And saying that, well, maybe the annex can last another 10 years instead of another 5 years simply begs the question. So are we being rushed into this because of the desire to purchase the Northfield property?
Thank you for your question. No, you're not being rushed into this. After 3 years of many options, A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, we have winnowed it down to one that appears, according to the architect, to give us a permanent, not a five-year Band-Aid, as has been said.
I listened to the architect. I was there. They said it could be done. It does not meet our needs. It meets the immediate needs and it is not what we wanted. It does not give us a good 21st century police station that this town needs. This town is old.
Thank you. Thank you for using those words.
You live with what you're told to do. Brian Williams was told to come back with a plan that stayed within the existing footprint of this building, and that's the only option that's been presented to the police commission. Not, we don't get a chance to decide on the older plans that we, I have a copy of the estimate, the $7.9 million estimates for the plans. A lot of us have them. And I haven't seen the other options to which you're talking. There is the one to bump out the back. But right now, the architect is telling you, this is what, you've given him what to work with, and that's how he's going to make it work. It doesn't mean that it's perfection. It doesn't mean that it's what we want. It means that if you came to our meeting in February, told us there were going to be plans presented to us March 1st that you wanted us to review. Those plans we have comments on. They have not been approved by the police commission. We haven't taken a vote on them, but those plans are just to renovate this building, and no other plans we be told by your administration can we consider. And that, to me, is a problem. These plans are out there, and we are being pushed. We are being pushed very hard to accept the renovation of the town hall as the police station going forward, and that is contingent on buying that Northfield Road property.
Correct.
And there are no other plans for a police station or public safety being considered at this time, and it does not consider land use and all the other things. That, so it's not a correct statement when you say all these options were out there and none of them were being acted on.
Susan, may I say something?
Sure.
I'm aware that you're making many assumptions and you are stating things for the record.
Nina, I don't say things for the record that I would not say off the record.
May
you
I
know me long enough to know that if I say something, it's based
can
on
we,
fact.
Can we please
and I sat at those meetings, Nina.
Susan,
don't
Susan.
Say that I'm just trying to posture.
Susan, I'm sorry. Could we speak
Excuse
one at a time?
Dennis. Yes.
Yeah, okay. Go ahead. Were you going to speak?
So, I am aware that an email was sent that I had stated that a vote was taken at the police commission.
There is no vote taken at the police commission.
Well, and you know I didn't say that either. Whoever told you that is spreading misinformation. One. Two, Humes has said, and Chief Troxell has agreed, and so has the police commissioner, that this is not a band-aid. This satisfies their need for long-term for a 21st century facility. You are stating, I didn't say that, Susan.
Excuse me. Can we just speak one at a time, please?
Excuse me.
Why don't you finish
I think we're going to call
okay.
time.
Right.
I think we're going to call time.
I just want to say a couple of things. You know, I want to congratulate you on the deal that you reached with the bank, because I really do think that the purchase price that you negotiated was an outstanding price, and I do hope the town goes forward and buys 48 Northfield, because as I've always said, I think it's important for the town. Whether we put land use in there or other offices, it's apparent that we need it for town facilities. The problem with the current plan, which by the way is not on the website, I would appreciate it if people could have actually had access to the plans that are there. There is no space needs comparison. So we started out this process with having the architect do a space needs analysis of what we need. So it's really hard to say whether we're meeting the needs or not unless
Correct.
We know the square footage comparison and can say, okay, instead of having 1,000 square feet for storage, we now have 200 or whatever it is that acceptable to the police, where they can go through, you know, department by department and determine whether this is something that's going to meet our long-term needs or not. If we can get away with what Chris told me was 2,000 square feet less in the space needs assessment, that's great, that's fantastic. I just don't think that we have all the information now to make that assessment.
Thank you very much, Cam. First of all, I also agree that the Gadara property is key to the future of this town.
48 Northfield.
48 Northfield. Thank you, Chris. It will serve any number of purposes, including allowing us to have a municipal commons. So it is something that is key to opening up possibilities for the next 5, 10, 20 years. Eventually, what I would hope, and it may be long after all of us are no longer coming to these meetings, that we will have four corners of Northfield, the historic four corners of Northfield. So Sarah asked, where are you going to put places that are going to come from the annex? possibly one of those other two buildings on the other corner, so that we would have a common, a large historic center of town that would serve our municipal needs. There are more than that option, Sarah. There are a number of options, but they're speculative at this point, and that is not what we're dealing with right now. So I do agree that Gudera is key to the future vision and keeping that an option that we can develop and expand upon later on is very, very appropriate for us to pursue right now. Excuse me, Alan, I'm going to finish.
Oh, it sounded like you were finishing. I'm sorry.
I think I finished. Go ahead.
I want to talk a little bit about Brian Hughes. He's a colleague of mine. I've gotten to know him very well. He's an excellent architect. He was an excellent choice for this project. And as far as the work that he did in trying to shoehorn the police department into this building, he did an excellent job. But he's an architect. If you asked him to build out a police department in this room, he'd figure out how that works. And he would do an excellent job. I mean, that's what he does. His job is not to analyze for this town whether it's the right or wrong thing to do. You've asked him, we've asked him to do a project, and he's able to do that project. And he's more competent than almost anybody else in respect to doing this kind of work that I've ever met. The problem is, because he's done an excellent job in designing the potential new police department in this building, and Chief Troxell says it meets our needs, that has absolutely nothing to do whether this is a good alternative for the town. Because the town is not just building a police department. It's moving office facilities. It has very soon outdated portables. And it has other needs that have to all be coordinated together with significant financial consequences. And in addition to that, it's setting the tone for what this town's going to be like for the next 50 to 100 years. Those are the needs that we need to consider as a town. Not whether Brian Humes has done a good job or not in terms of making this an adequate police facility.
So,
and that's what we're missing. And when I keep hearing that this is the job we're doing, this is the project we've chosen to do, I don't even know who we are at that point.
I don't know what you're referring to.
Well, you keep referring to this project as if this idea of buying Northfield and turning it into town offices was something that was developed and then voted upon and agreed to by a group of people.
I don't know what you're talking about, Alan.
You know?
No, I don't.
Can anybody explain this?
But I'd like to go back and agree with you. I really don't know what you're talking about.
I think what Alan's asking.
I've been misquoted so often that I'm getting concerned about that.
I didn't quote you.
What you said? Then what are you talking about?
I'm curious as to how the idea was germinated, how it came about.
What idea?
That we should actually put town offices into Northfield. Where'd that come from?
My God, that was discussed almost three years ago when Ms. Weinstein went to the public to buy 48 Northfield with the idea that it would be used for town offices.
That's a good discussion, but who decided that this was the only way to proceed at this point?
I don't know what you're talking about. Who decided? Oh, okay, all right, just a second. First of all, let me go back, because you're throwing out so many things at once. You complimented Humes on his judgment. So I asked Humes today all the devil's advocate questions that I'm hearing right now. I asked him specifically, you know best, Humes, what we need as a town. You understand our facilities needs, and the police department is your specialization. I want to be sure that this is not a band-aid, this is not a five-year solution. He said to me, and others were in the room to hear it, it is a 21st century police station that will be there as long as you need it. So one, excuse me, I want to finish. Two, I said, given money and cost, is this as good as having a new police station? And what are we losing? Because the new police station is about $8 million. This is about under $3 million. I wanted to, and also the new police station has all kinds of other consequences that bring it up to more like $9 million when you finish it.
But this is also not more than $3 million.
Wait a second, may I finish?
Right.
All right, I said, given the price differential, please tell me, what are we losing for that additional $4, $5, $6, $7 million? He said nothing, basically he said nothing critical.
Let me just finish up. You know, with all due respect, you're both confusing and conflating two different issues. Because half of what you say is correct. It's true.
I'm just telling you what my questions were and his response.
Is it that you're not understanding what he's saying to you, or are you just conflating it for the purpose of trying to get this done?
Conflating means I'm putting two things together.
You are.
What two things are you putting?
Brian Hughes has no idea what is good for this community. But he certainly has a good idea about how to plan a police station. That's where you're conflating these two things.
I agree completely.
Yes. And you can't put those two things in the same sentence because one does not prove the other. And that's what you're trying to make happen here.
And for the record, you know, I asked him when he came, is this a long-term police department? And his answer was yes. That doesn't mean it addressed any of the other issues in town. As a police department, I also followed up and asked him, how did we get this plan? And his response to me was, I was given a budget of $2.4 million and asked what I can do with it. So he backed into that plan. I understand the reason for that 2.4, because attached to the 2.4 and the renovation of 48, you know, gets us to a point where we can do this without bonding. So I think that was what was being, what was driving its argument. It doesn't mean it's the only option. It's an option that's being pursued now. Now, you had asked earlier, who is this we who decided that this is the only plan?
Do you understand that?
I do understand it. And I don't think there was a decision, because as far as I know, nobody has, and I've said this, is I think we should look at options. And as I said in a meeting, and I used A, B, and C, and we talked about alphabets, that the first option was looked at, it was deemed expensive for what it was, it is what it is. So the first selectman had proposed a second option, right? And that option involves, you know, pulling in other parts, and now you came in, we suggested moving through the process that you normally do, the advisory review, and giving us your opinions on whether this is gonna work. It may or may not work. Once it works, my hope and expectation is we look at it in conjunction with what has to be done with everything else, the annex, making sure this is sufficient, making sure we have a proper gateway to town, making sure we're ADA compliant within the historic district requirements, and then doing an apples to apples comparison and say, is this the best plan? So from my perspective, everything I've heard in these meetings, and I can only speak for what I've heard in these meetings, I don't think anything is definitive yet. Now, other stuff may be going on, and it may be locked down, that this is the only thing we're looking at. My hope is that we're going to look at everything in a complete, comprehensive way, because, you know, putting money down and then having to redo it is not fair to further generations coming out. So we have to do a good job. Hume said the police part was great, and nobody's debating whether the police... It is 2,000 square feet less than the needs assessment, but he said it would do. There's some compromises. We have to do some stuff at town hall, but this is one of the options being looked at, is my understanding. And again, that's just my understanding. So I don't know if that answers your earlier question.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
You have to say your name and your street.
I'm on the library board, and we have been working on the library renovation for years. In the past year, when we've actually been working with the architect and had the ability to look at plans, and as we've worked through these, I can tell you, things have come up, like asbestos in the tiles, things that we hadn't taken into account. I think when you get into an old building like this, you're going to get the same problem. To back into a number of 2.4 million is just outrageous. You can't do that. You have to have a better budget available to you, or you're not going to get the job done. I don't care what your job is, you can't do that.
Absolutely, and that's the reason we're now doing a full evaluation of what the costs are. The initial assumption that I had heard initially when we were looking at 48 Northfield was it'd be maybe $200,000, $250,000. Now I'm hearing it might be significantly more. If we end up having to pay $1.5 million, we're gonna have to reevaluate, would a reasonable person buy that building for $1 million?
I didn't understand. Now you're hearing what?
I'm hearing that the expenses might be significantly more than the $200,000 to $250,000. The chimneys are separating, the envelope is not secure, there's no HVAC system, we're gonna have to make it ADA compliant. There's all sorts of things we're going to have to consider.
The generators
so, and I don't know, and I'm not an expert, and that those numbers will be given to us at some point. But if those numbers, right, and if those numbers come back that way, then we say, you know, the idea was there, but now we have to change the parameters of what we're looking at because things have changed. And, you know, then we're going to be doing apples to apples, as Dennis suggested. Well, this is going to end up costing. And the issue is if the repairs on that, and it bumps us into having to bond anyway, well, then we need to reopen the discussion about what we're doing. So you know, my expectation is we go through the normal checks and balances and procedures that we do through town. The building committee is now taking this up. They have 7 wonderful experts. They started the first phase. They're getting bids. We're going to hear back from the architects, and we're going to hear their appraisal.
But why are we not getting firm bids on all of the options so that we can look and evaluate and say, here are the 3 choices. Here is what it will actually cost. Now it's going
to. I assume we're going to do that.
Well, once that's we get a very. That is an exceedingly expensive process. I talked to Brian today, and I said, if we really wanted to, he gave us prices. This $3.3 million you heard about, he went through and he sort of costed out his revised plan for the police station renovation and renovating the space that would be co-opted. If you may remember, 2 or 3 weeks ago, he was here at this board meeting. He had a plan, and he had a cost of $2.4 million for that. And then after that meeting, a meeting with the police commission the next week, it was like, now you got to redo this plan. There's right. Things here we can't live with. Well, he did, and that's 3.3. So he didn't pull it out of the air. But when we talked to him today, because frankly, I said, I don't have 3.3. Okay, I can't make that plan work. If that's really what it is, that plan's off the table for us. And he said, and I can tell you sort of how I got there and all that, you know, if you want. If you want to give me five minutes, I'll give you the start to the end of the whole process. But he said, well, Tom, in order to...
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of important.
Okay, let me finish this point.
Okay.
He said, but in order to do that, I really have to design the thing and then cost it out. And I said, well, how much is that? He said, probably about 75% of the architecture and engineering fee. And I said, well, I'm looking on the plan, Brian, and you've got that estimated at $235,000. He says, yeah. So 75% is like, what, 170, 175? Yeah. He said, you give me that, I can give you a decent cost. He said, you know, I don't really know that I don't want to do that and like 3 times, okay? Because every option you're doing. But so let me give you sort of, because so much of like, you know, who did this and who, so many times the answer to that is you're looking at it. When this global plan was done, you know, the global $10.9 million plan, it was actually more than $10.9 actually.
Thank you, Tom.
Because it didn't include the fire station roof, I don't think, which is a couple hundred thousand. It didn't include the new dispatch equipment, which is $550,000. And I don't think it included the cost of the bond issue, which was a little over $100,000. I don't think it included the demo of the annex. So, you know, you can look on the sheet, the all-in most expensive option was $10.9, but it was more than that. It was probably like
then you need to add those costs onto this project.
We still have to do
that. Yeah, I haven't gotten it yet, okay? So give me the 5 minutes. So then we have an election, and I'm told, these two guys right here said, I'm not doing any bonds. Forget no bonds. I can tell you 10.9.
That's not quite what happened.
Well,
my eyes
that's how I heard. You give me the 5 minutes too, please. So the 10.9, there's no way I can get 10.9 without a bond issue. So what I'm left with is the money I think I have. I have been stuffing cash in a drawer for this debt. And that's why when you look at our general fund balance of 17 point something percent, which is, you know, way more than you need. So, well, how much do you need? Board of Finance has said, well, we want to maintain it 10 to 12% as a policy. So I'll tell you what, let's take it to 11. And if I go from the 17 point whatever to the 11, I've got $4.2 million, okay? Of your money, you've got $4.2 million. I don't have $4.2 million to renovate a police station because I've got to do $550 for this equipment and $200 for the roof. Now, I am then left with two, I think, financially viable options. One is buy a building next door, have the police inhabit that space. Or, you don't buy the building next door, everybody stays put, we do an addition to the police station. Okay? To me, those are the two financially viable options that you have. Maybe someone else got three, four, no, I don't like this one. That's what I think you have financially working within the money that's available. So if you took the 4.2, right, and took out the other, it's 2.4. So I go to Brian and say, Brian, I've got $2.4 million. This is what I have in mind. You need to do an analysis and tell me whether you can do a viable police station for that. If you can, we're going to continue talking. If you can't, there's no point in doing it. That would indeed be the band-aid. He went through, developed that plan that was presented a few weeks ago. It further got morphed. Now, as we've looked at that building, the number I've used for that building is $1 million. So you know what the purchase option is, 710. That means 290 in renovations. We've, you know, the building committee, I know someone said two, we actually invited three firms. We didn't go out and do like a world broadcast, oh, we want architects. We talked to people we knew and have worked with before. One was KG&D. They did the doors and windows project at the two schools. They said, too busy, sorry, we'd love to do it, we can't do it within that time frame. We talked to Peter Gisolfi and Associates. They're doing the library work right now. The building committee's been very pleased with them. And then we talked to a guy named Phil Cerrone. He's an architect in Fairfield. He did the Lions Plains fire station. Okay? He's doing a bunch of other things in town. I guess he's well known to the building department. So the building committee talked to those two firms a couple of nights ago. And they said, boy, these guys are really good. And so they've asked them to give them a financial proposal, and they'll get that in the next few days, and then they're going to meet Wednesday night and make a decision. And they'll say, well, okay, we've looked at everything. These are the guys we think are the best for the job, and they'll recommend it to the selectmen. And on Monday, April 4th at their meeting, or if they meet before, they'll say, okay, here's what we think you should hire. We told you you need some help. Here's a guy, and here's what we think it costs. So that'll play out. For the global... And I should just say, through that discussion, several people, there are people who want to buy that house because they just want to own that house, okay? It has many other options, they just, you know, the romance. That's not why I want to buy that house. I'm not into romance. I'm not into owning old buildings that are royal pain in the neck. I am into solving a police issue, okay? That's what I'm trying to do. And I told you, I got two ways potentially to do it. So they're going to go through and work that out, and you know, if there's some sort of residual goodwill number, they think, well, you know, maybe it's not the greatest for that, but it actually has this other thing where we can do like these great grand community designs that we so sorely need, you know, hooray. But that's not why we're doing it. Now, in terms of the global fix, right, the $10.9 million, which is, you know, actually more fix. I am the person who said, you know those guys up in the annex? Forget about it. We're told 2 years ago or last year, we were told by the Board of Ed, those buildings have 8 years left. We weren't told 10, we weren't told 5, we were told 8. And it might have been last year, but I think it was two years ago. So there's 6 left, if they are correct. So you know, I'm just going to leave it alone. It's working for a bunch of years. We'll come back in 5 years, and we'll do one of several things or some several other things, okay? I think my charge for this is to fix the problem I'm trying to fix without screwing that up. So one of the things in that whole equation, one of sort of the benefits of the, you know, the 10.9 plan was we're all one big happy. Everyone's here together, you keep an eye on them, you're a resident, you get services. You go one place, you really can't get lost, all right? Here, you know, now, in order to do that, that was a more expensive option. And so you can, reasonable people can differ and say, you know what, if it's $1.5 million more, it's worth it. You know, well, maybe it's worth it if only $100,000 more. I mean, I sort it out, okay? They're up there, it's working, leave them alone. What happens 5 or 6 years from now? The truth is, I don't know, but here's some potentials. Maybe we feel differently about putting people in North House in 5 or 6 years. Maybe, I know you don't.
You will not. Right? This town will not feel differently about that. That is a specious argument. You should stop it.
No, it's an argument. You don't. No. Come on. I'm down to my last.
Can we just let Tom
I'm down to my last minute.
Take
okay,
please.
maybe the enrollments are such that the Board of Ed can move in back into that wing of the middle school. They talked about that. And if they do that, well, you know what? Guess what? They're not in the central office. And guess what? Maybe that's big enough now to put the people from the building office, land use, which is 4,000 square feet, into there. You renovate, you put them into there. I don't know. Worst case scenario, you're blowing up the annex, you're building a 4,000 square foot annex for them, everybody else is going into a school. I don't know. In order to know what your assessment or what your potential is then, you have to know kind of what enrollments are, kind of how other things look. In 2020, you'll know what 2020 enrollments are. Here, I'm only guessing, right? Now, whatever you do then, it's going to cost millions. I don't know how many millions, it's going to cost millions. You have the grand benefit, all of the $80 million, $67 million that we bonded for the school project. Beginning around 2022, the payments go from $6 million a year to $4 to $2 to $0. Guess what? We can do some bonding then. You know what, and people won't go frenetic about it. You know what the bonding is the next several years? About the same. It's really not going about $100,000, it goes down. So to take on this $10.9 million when I've got maybe four on hand, four and a half, you know, something like that. You're still bonding a big nut. People have to pay that. You know, assessment was that it's really not the time to do that. So all of that, you know, you don't have to agree with any of that. But there is, I'd hate to say a vision, but there is sort of a plan on how to approach it. Things do fit into place. You know, maybe you'll, you don't like how they fit, maybe you do. Maybe you like, you know, two parts of it, no other part of it. But it is, there's sort of a logical order. And it begins with the premise that, you know, we don't have access to bond money. We have access to what we have. Now, in terms of the revised plan, just this is the last point. So Brian gives us a revised plan a couple of days ago, and it's $3.3 million. So Brian, look, I'm a little short here. I just can't do that. Part of this concept is EMS has talked about wanting space and that they would throw in some money to do it, and that's like very expensive to do. I mean, they would sort of have to cover that themselves, and then maybe we can, right? But you know, if they don't, that's not really an option that's going to work unless we, you know, we don't go to 11%. We go to, you know, bring the fund balance down to 10.5 or 10, or you know, we shave some costs some other way. So anyway, that's the grand view. A lot of options were looked at. And one of the things I've told Nina, you know, I mean, like a lot of folks who get elected, right, they have the vision thing. And they go, well, I want to do this with that or that with that. Look, I don't need people not liking what you think you want to do in 5 years. I don't need you voting no against this because you're afraid building inspector is going to go into North House, right? Just leave it alone. People in 2020, they'll have 2020 information. They'll be good, capable people. They'll figure it out.
The one caveat I'll throw out there to the delay issue, just so, because that was a beautiful summary of kind of the history of it, is historically low interest rates. Now, have you looked at any assumptions in terms of expectations, what they rise and how that would affect the net present value of bonding now versus having to do it in 5 years if we ended up having to do it anyway? That was an issue.
Our estimates now, the models we did, I think we're using 2.75%. I don't know what they are in 5 years. I think that, you know, we're expecting it to be more than that. I also think we expect we're bonding a lot less than, you know, what we'll be bonding today. So it's like there's two parts to that equation.
Sure.
You know, I mean, if I knew what interest rates were doing, I wouldn't be working here, right? My guess is that it's going to be, right? Most people say it's probably going to be more.
Well, it's definitely, I mean, we're at historic low rates, I think. It's just one thing to keep in mind. Again, that was an amazing summary. I think I would like to say that this meeting has been extremely illuminative of the entire process that led up to how we got here now, and I think now we've got some amazing transparency, I'd have to say, and you know, the town's going to eventually be the ones who are going to actually put those votes to the machines and make the final decision.
All right, so I had 3 points. I can only remember two of them. The first one is there was absolutely no discussion of the operating costs of the buildings. The town hall annex is currently the most expensive building in the town to operate, and we're we're talking about, and again, I feel like I'm a broken record here, a historic building, which again, I assume will have much higher operating costs than a new facility. Number two, Nina, I would like to hear from you right now. I know you voted no, that you would not put town offices in school buildings. Do you support that idea, or are you opposed to it?
I would not put land use or those types of offices in North House. My fundamental position has always been that school educational property should be used for educational purposes.
Thank you.
Thank you. I want to thank Tom also. I'd like to say what the public is not aware of is that these questions have all been addressed, but they can't be addressed always this way. They have been addressed. They're good questions. They're good things to review. I'm grateful that all you have come out tonight to ask these questions. What I'd like to tell you is when I first came to office, I'm invited by every municipal agency to come into the first meeting. In going to those meetings, I listened to what I was asked and did what was indicated to me were the wishes of the key stakeholders. I listened, these were public meetings, and I never heard any great enthusiasm for a new building. I think everybody is aware the economy in Connecticut is not doing well. We have flatlined for the last 5 years. If we bond now, our taxes will go up. If we don't need to bond, and if we can find a more affordable option, which this is, we can do what we need to do over time when it becomes required of us to do that. Yes, Sarah.
I'm sorry. I remember my last point, which yes. is, Tom, I absolutely appreciate the position you're in, and Nina, I hear what you just said. However, the people that work in this town hall do not live here. Some of them might, but as a taxpayer, and Tom, I think, lives in Fairfield and is retiring within the next year, the long-term future of this town, the taxpayers are the ones that live here.
Absolutely
and
right.
And they're the ones that should be involved in making these decisions.
Absolutely right.
Not a town administrator who is being forced into a budget because we're not even considering all the options.
And Sarah, so I agree with you. This is a town vision that needs to be decided upon by the town. And my family's been here for 50 years. Yes.
And I'd like to say that this is better than anything that's on television tonight.
Is this on television?
Yeah.
Yes.
So
television.
We're talking about
real television.
Yes, Gail.
I just want to say that I really appreciate you allowing this discussion to take place tonight. I am going to give you a copy of the Global Facilities Report, which I did in October, which I'm not sure you got. One of the things that you're not taking into consideration, which I ask you to consider, are operational savings from hibernating North House as well as closing the annex. You also have to include the senior center, which Great. Could eventually, you know, as you and I both tried to take credit for, moved to Central Opportunity Center.
I read about it first.
Which right now, if you want to say it's your idea, I'm happy to say go for it and do that because I think it's great for the community. But we have operational savings when we consider that of anywhere between 60 and I think it was 180,000 by doing that.
By doing what? Refer back.
By hibernating North House and taking the annex offline, taking into consideration the operating costs of a new building, taking into cost of either doing addition renovation, there are different options in here. So I'm going to ask you to also consider that, because I think when you talk about the cost of bonding, the number would go down. If you eliminated 2,000 square foot from the estimate of the building, that would take 7.9 down to 6.9. I work with DEP to allow us to hook up to Hurlbut, which eliminates another 600,000 from there. So now we're under $6.5 million to build a new police station. Not that I'm saying that you still want a bond, but I think you need to look at all of those numbers and consider the operational savings. Because once you bond only $2.5-3 million, the operational savings that you would get by being able to combine all of our buildings, which is how this process began initially, declining enrollment, how are we going to consolidate space and save some operational costs, you'll see that it's actually more efficient over time and save the town a lot more money if we took that route. So I will give you a copy.
Thank you. I would question that. I would question whether the operational cost savings should be spent on bonding. So I would question that. In other words, if
you can't get
have,
it without the without me, doing
if we well the annex will be coming down eventually,
but
and
they
North
have to go
House
somewhere.
Can be that's true.
Right.
But they may go within they may go within the school campus existing buildings. What I'm trying to say is if there is an opportunity for cost savings, my first choice would not to be to find a way to spend it. My first choice would be to return that in some kind of a tax benefit to the town. Yes, sir. Your name and...
Michael Schlechter, Woods End Lane. So, if we look at it, just going back to my lovely and talented wife's point, we're really talking about total cost of ownership over the scope of 10 years or 15 years of bonding. I sit here at 38 years of age with a 10-year-old in this town, so I'm going to be here for a while. And I certainly can understand why a mere 4 years out of 2020 does seem short-term. But to me, it actually seems like pretty much next Thursday. So, if we're thinking that we are going to know we have problems coming 4 years hence, and not make a plan that is flexible enough to address them, I think we've failed. I partially own and run a business. I've got a 5-year and a 10-year plan. My funders, my partners, and my co-owners require that of me. So if our plan is going to establish a 4-year timeline, putting off problem, not taking advantage of cost savings, historically low debt, and saying we might change our mind on things like security, or that we might have reduced needs somehow, I don't know, that does seem pretty. When I say security, the thought of putting anything that is not education related in North House is what I'm talking about. I encourage you to read the Columbine and St. Joe reports, and you'll see a trend, and that is access. So by providing access to non-educational people to a school facility, they will plan.
They will plan.
They're able to plan. So
they will plan.
So if you look at, just let's be very specific about why in four years you will not be putting town offices. I understand you're talking just...
Not under my administration.
Well, good, then I don't have to make that point. So the point is, though, we're talking about capping our plan here at 4 years, not taking advantage of starting low bill rates. Yes, you're right. If we spend every ounce of savings, they are not savings. However, if we spend every ounce of savings, and then in 10 years, we can realize a net savings is the way to say it, a net negative gain. It actually does save the town money over the life of the actual project. My concern is that you're taking a 4-year or a 3-year view.
I think Mr. Landry addressed that concern already.
No, he didn't. He said that you'll figure it out in 2020.
I will respond to it. We're not taking a 3 or 4-year view. We're not going to do anything unless we think about the long term.
Well, then why are we taking bonding off the table?
Because we spent a couple of years talking about a new police station, and after a lot of discussion, there was, in my mind, very serious concern about the amount of money we were spending, and very serious concern about increasing the tax burden on the residents of this town and making it much less competitive for people who are moving here and for people who live here. And we looked for an alternative which did not require that kind of an investment. And we are about to have a report which tells us whether that alternative, which is much less expensive in the many millions of dollars, will or will not work. And then we're going to present that to the town, and it can be compared to the prior plans, which included significant bonding, and everybody can make a decision.
So within a fortnight between the previous meeting and the meeting you had today, you had a 32% increase from $2.4 to $3.1 million, which puts you outside your budget parameter. So it means that the plan that everyone thinks is viable, which doesn't mean, I'm not saying build a new building. I'm talking about the viable plan you've discussed today. Purchasing 48 Garfield, doing a renovation here, and whatever all the other machinations are. You are at least $1 million over budget. So you either scrap the plan and we do status quo, or you have to find $1 million.
It's not, I don't think your numbers are correct.
Your numbers are not correct.
The numbers Tom just spoke.
No, he didn't say that.
He said we went from 2.4 to 3.3, so you're
900,000. The revenue thing, it's very complicated. Yeah. I'm not sure this is being productive, but I do appreciate everybody being here. We appreciate very much your concerns and the seriousness and the sincerity with which you bring them forth. It is getting late, and I'm going to suggest that we now have a motion to adjourn.
And again, one way or another, the citizens of the town are going to have a vote on the final decision. So the voice will be heard.
Do you have something going on in executive session?
Yes, we do. So
will you be going out of executive session?
Not necessarily.
Gail, did you want?
You certainly can go into executive session to discuss real estate negotiations, but you can't go into executive session to discuss a search committee update. The only personnel matters that you can discuss are if you have an issue and you want to reprimand an employee, in which case you have to state the name of the employee that you're talking about, but you can't discuss a search committee update in executive session.
Thank you.
May I have a motion? Are we ready to go into executive session?
Yep, move to go into executive session.
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
You need to state why.
For real estate negotiations regarding 48 Northfield Road and anything appropriate.
No, no, we're going into executive committee also to talk about the search committee. That is excluded from open meetings. So that's a good, a valid basis for an executive session.
I'm sorry, Susan was talking.
My fault.
Would you repeat what you just said?
I said the motion is to go into executive session to talk about both 48 Northfield negotiations and a personnel search committee.
But you can't discuss the search committee in executive session. That's not one of the valid exceptions for FOI.
Thank you.
Motion second.
Seconded?
Second.
All in favor?
All right.